you enjoyed a peaceful Sunday. This is Joy, and I welcome and thank you for joining me today. It's my hope that I offer you support through the content that I share and that you experience peace and love as you journey on in life. Today, I'd like to talk to you about flying monkeys. Many times we hear narratives that they are used by the narcissist, which yes, they are, but they are most definitely willing participants. There are instances when all the narcissist has to do is say your name and state a fact about you, and that low-level demon goes running to gather information on you to report back to the narcissist, or come and report back to you what the narcissist is up to, or just plain and simple engage in demonic activity to bother you to the point where you become frustrated. It slows down your progress in life, or just cause you some type of harm. These little punks are not innocent. They are completely willing and ready to engage in this toxic behavior. The only time I could consider them innocent is when they are children and they are manipulated by a narcissistic parent to be a flying monkey. And when I say children, I mean young children, not teenagers or adults who can actually reason for themselves. Now, where am I going with all of this? Well, let me say this. In my opinion, and I can't wait to hear your comments or to read your comments, in my opinion, they are workers of iniquity on assignment. Let's not forget, people, this is a battle. We are at war, and we cannot excuse their behavior at all. And if we are aware that we are at war, then there are enemies that are going to come in to throw us off our feet. The flying monkey is by no stretch of the imagination innocent. The devil cannot be present to do all his evil-filled work. The devil will use these flying monkeys to go and feed these low-down, dirty, dusty, raggedy behind narcissists to help them bring chaos, confusion, and misery into your life. I want to share another perspective with you today. My goal is to highlight the insidious work of the devil. When we consider the devil, we know he is sly, cunning, and presents an illusion to those whom he wants to indoctrinate into his cult. Because he cannot be in all places at all times, and he is not all-knowing, he has to employ these minions to do his work. Consider these minions the busted down raggedy punk behind the narcissist that we encounter, very, very low level demons. They are nothing more than puppets on a string living an illusion that they bought into from the ultimate narcissist, the devil. The most delusional creature to walk this earth or roam this earth, the devil. One thing we know about delusional people is that they are in fact very desperate people. The devil, he's desperate because he knows his time is running out, and he is trying his best to gather as many souls as possible to indoctrinate them into his cults. This is why he uses flying monkeys. I want to remind you about the story of Samson and Delilah in the Old Testament. It's found in the book of Judges, chapters 13 through 16. I'm not going to read that. It's three whole chapters. Samson was special to God, and I say this because his birth is a miracle. His mother was barren. She could not get pregnant, but God sends an angel to tell her that she shall have a son and how she should prepare her body. See it that you drink no wine or other fermented drink, and that you do not eat anything unclean. Those were specific instructions for her in chapter 13, verse 4. The next verse goes on to tell her that she will have a son, and it instructs her that no razor should ever touch his head. And it goes on to say, the boy is a Nazarite, dedicated to God from the womb. He will take the lead in delivering Israel from the hands of the Philistines. There was purpose attached to Samson's name, from the womb. So when we look at Samson, he had great purpose. And the chief narcissist had to send confusion, chaos, and drama into Samson's life. Please read those three chapters for yourself. Even if you already know the story, just go back and read it and try to look at this story through a fresh lens. Ask God to reveal things to you in this story that relates to narcissistic abuse, codependency, as well as these flying monkeys. You see, Samson ends up marrying a Philistine woman, Delilah. She is from the tribe of the very people whom he is sent to deliver the children of Israel out of. So here's what I want you to know. One of the tools that the enemy employs is strongholds. And one of these strongholds is seducing spirits. Now, here's a quick categorization of seducing spirits. See, number one, they work by flattery. Two, they're persistent. They never take no for an answer. Three, they choose to manipulate you or may turn others to do that. Four, they pressure targets to get them to violate their own conscience or break down principles. Five, they focus on your weakness and play upon it because they want power over you. Six, they have the ability to use your blind spots and hurt to cast a spell that is meant to send you into confusion and disillusionment. And seven, seducing spirits are self-absorbed and proud, yet can appear humble and very insecure, but really are confident, and they are always a taker and never a giver. Does this sound like anyone that you know? Think about it. And I didn't just make up this list, but it's actually available, and I'm going to attach the website in the description. It's on scottsimon.com. So these are seducing spirits, and we can see all these traits within narcissists, but they exist within these flying monkeys too. And I had to reflect on the flying monkeys that I have experienced and encountered in my life. And that's when I began to see the similarities. Delilah was a seducing spirit, acting on behalf of the Philistines because they knew there was a mandate on Samson's life, and they had to send a flying monkey to go and get the 411 on what made Samson so strong. What is the secret of your strength? This seducing spirit, flying monkey, keeps asking Samson. She knew, listen, she was not in the dark. She knew why they wanted this secret. She knew they wanted to overpower him. And this is very clear in black and white in chapter 16, verse 5. The flying monkeys are not innocent. The flying monkeys know what is happening. And there was a price. Each one of us will give you 1,100 shekels of silver. That was a promise to her that she would receive that silver if she gave them the correct information. That low-down, double-dealing, good-for-nothing, broke heifer was willing to help the Philistines capture her husband, all for a little change. Yes, a little change. She was that broke and busted down. Now, I know it may seem like a lot of money, but for the person that you love, there is no price. That's why she's broke down and busted. She asks him, and just like that, and you know, she asks him, she keeps asking him, what is the secret to your strength? And he lies. He lies to her, and she even says to him, if you were to be tired and overpowered, if you were to be tied and overpowered, how would somebody do this? What is the secret to your strength? Just like that busted down narcissist, she gives herself up. She tells what it is. And what does Samson do? Instead of hearing what she is saying, he kind of acts like how I know at least I did. And I know some of you will be able to identify with this too. You hear what the narcissist is saying. You hear what the flying monkeys are saying. And yet we don't hear. We find a way to not trust what we are hearing, to question our judgment, or to seek some type of evidence. Remember, your intuition does not require evidence. And in this case, it's clear. It's in black and white. She told him that she was looking for information and why she wanted that information. But he explains it away. He tries to reason it away. He looks at his wife, seducing spirit, hello, and he cannot just, you know, call her out or get out of the situation then. You have to read the whole story so that you can get to the end of the story. But, you know, absolutely nothing, and I mean nothing, that is under the sun is new. Absolutely nothing. These demons think that they actually have victory over us, but the truth is they don't. Delilah is definitely a flying monkey, broke down, wannabe bougie, raggedy heifer. She knew she had to go and report to the narcissist that sent her after her husband, who, remind you, or remember, was anointed, in the womb. And if you know how the story, like, please go and read how this story ends if you don't know. Delilah is doing nothing more than doing, well, she's doing nothing more than the narcissist's bidding. That is what flying monkeys do. They are not innocent. Again, they are just as guilty as the narcissist, working in tandem with the devil to take you out of your purpose. And I want to remind you of some words that apply to you too. They're found in the book of Jeremiah, verse 1, chapter 5. Before I formed you in your mother's womb, I knew you. Before you were born, I set you apart. I appointed you. There is purpose attached to your name. Yes, these are words that were spoken to Jeremiah, but they apply to you too, because guess what? God is not an economist. He does not just make people to make people. He has a purpose for every single person that he creates. There is purpose on your name. There is an assignment with your name attached to it. And just like Samson was appointed before his birth, he was anointed in the womb, so are you. You are no different. There is a mandate on your life too. And this is why these raggedy, broke, busted down flying monkeys work with these low-level demon narcissists to take you out of your purpose. And I know that some of you have some amazing stories about how you were born and the world that you came into and how you were raised and the challenges that you faced, all because the enemy wants to infiltrate your life and your peace and your mind and your sanity. It's no accident. These minions are on assignment and they work diligently, because if they fail on their assignment to indoctrinate you and keep you in the harem, the love cult, and keep you asleep on your purpose and destiny, they are punished. They are punished. Every time one of us breaks free, every time one of us wakes up, every time one of us speaks out, they are punished. Why do you think when the narcissist runs out of supply and is in a collapsed state that they become depressed? That's when they really, we don't feel sorry for them, but they are just so desperate and so low. I mean, like, they are just low down every day, but they're depressed and looking extra, extra raggedy on those days because they are on punishment. Hello, who wants to live in that tortured being? Not even the narcissist, but they're too raggedy to know that, hello, check out of that camp. And that's why we do not help them. That's why we do not go back and try to save them, because you can only save somebody who wants to be saved. You can only help somebody who wants to be helped. And the narcissist is doing just fine where they are. And so are these raggedy flying monkeys. So leave them. Focus on yourself. Focus on healing yourself. Focus on breaking free out of that spell. Focus on the people who you can help that are in these situations, that are seeking the truth, that are trying to come out. Help them. But never give up on yourself. Never lose hope. Never lose faith, because if you flip all the way to the end of the book, the victory is in you. The victory is yours. You have been powered from day one. Anointed and appointed. You are the winner. You cannot give up. If you give up, guess who wins? Guess which raggedy, dusty behind is rewarded when you give up? Nah, let that joker feel the pain of a collapsed state. Let that joker feel the wrath of their punk behind leader. You have been fashioned and formed in divinity. Your destiny is not going to be dictated by your nativity. It doesn't matter how you were born. It's inconsequential to where you are going. So continue to rise. Rise up, my sisters and brothers. We need you. This community needs you. Your city, your state, this world needs you. There's a mandate on your life. And while you continue, or should you be blind to that, then they win. But guess what? That's not what this is about. You are victorious through Christ who saves you, through Christ who loves you, through Christ who laid his life down for you. And so focus on that. Focus on what your strengths are. Remember, all it takes is faith the size of a mustard seed. Now, if you look at a mustard seed, it's so tiny. It's like a speck of sand. But imagine that tiny seed, faith the size of a mustard seed, that when it's nurtured in the ground, it grows. And it doesn't just remain a seed, but it becomes something that is able to bear fruit. Bear fruit. Let your life bear fruit. So I just want to take a moment to thank you so much for being with me on this journey and for really trusting me. I'm still learning, I'm still growing, and I'm still figuring some things out. And I'm just so grateful that you are here and that we can participate in this phase of our lives together. So until the next video, take care of yourself and take care of each other.